and were hanged. And it's a historical thing that happened in the American colonies, but back then, before it was officially America, this happened. There was witch trials, there were hunts, there were neighbors turned against neighbors, and it was this huge thing. And Arthur Miller wrote a very famous play about it, The Crucible. So then when Adam Simon, who created the show, came up with this idea to make a TV show about it, as though the witches of Salem were real witches. It was quite appealing because I think, personally, as a woman who feels incredibly sad and angry about how women have been treated historically, hunted and burned and hanged as witches, for me, it seemed like a really great opportunity to take some revenge by playing a character, exploring this historical moment through the lens of, like, what if these witches were actually real doing witchcraft? It's a really fun horror twist on, like, on history. And also, for me, it felt really cool to play a woman who, well, I don't want to do any spoilers for listeners, but it felt like a really great opportunity to explore the persecution of women and witches, and the persecution of kind of these people who back then didn't really have a voice. It was really fun to be able to explore the power dynamics at play, and also, like, imagine what would have happened if witches really were real in that time. What kind of revenge would they have taken on these terrible people?
And are you a big fan of playing supernatural roles? Are you a sort of a sci-fi queen? Do you sort of like the whole genre of sci-fi in terms of being able to explore different realities or alternate times, dare I say?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. I have found myself in quite a few different roles, in sort of alternate or science fiction or fantasy kind of stories. I'm not particularly drawn to sci-fi or fantasy. I'm really drawn to interesting characters. And I do really love the opportunity that certain writers give actors, and that's in the sci-fi and fantasy genres, you can play someone pretty cool. You can explore quite tricky and difficult subject matters, but in this kind of other world, so, or in an alternate reality, so you can kind of explore them in a way that you can get really deep into them. And I think that's something that's always appealed to me about sci-fi and fantasy, for sure.
And
But the real
Tamzin,
queen of sci-fi has been Lucy Lawless, so
yes,
it was
very
amazing to work with her.
Xena, the warrior princess. We'll never let that
That's
iconic character go. Tamzin, in
iconic.
terms of going to Louisiana and the United States to film this, and the three, I think it's three to four seasons, if I'm correct, just off the
Three
top of my
seasons,
head.
yeah.
Yeah, and Tamzin, being involved in that sort of length of a project, were you in Los Angeles at the time? Were you situated there when you heard about the audition, and or was it something that came a cropper from your US agents when you were in the UK at the time, and you said, yeah, this is something I really like?
Well, funnily enough, I was actually in Romania when I got the audition.
Oh.
So I was in Romania, and I was doing a film there called Dragonheart 3, which was fun. And I got sent this script for Salem, and I read it, and it was an immediate yes from me. I wanted to audition. I wanted this part. I really loved it. And the reason that I got sent the script and got asked to audition was because they'd seen me in The Tudors, which is a show that I shot in Ireland. And they'd seen me, and they obviously thought there was something about my character in that made them think of the character that they were casting, the character of Anne Hale. So I was in Romania, and I did an audition tape in a hotel room, as a lot of actors do a lot of the time now. And I heard back a little while later. And so I was based in England at the time, but I moved to Louisiana for 6 months of the year for 3 years, and we shot on this backwards location. That was really cool. It was they built the whole town of Salem in the woods next to this lake. And it was a really atmospheric set. You could go walking on it and it felt really like you were in the Salem Bay in 1692. It was very cool. And I think that really comes across in the show as well.
And Tamzin, in terms of your accent now, it's very mellow in terms of a UK sort of accent. It's not a strong sort of dialect or sort of a
Was
strong tone. Did that obviously appeal really that you could really maybe sort of the fix in with this sort of the 1800s back in no, the 1600s back in the USA that that your voice sort of was a good sort of cliche? Because I imagine the sort of the tone of the acting, if you someone had a strong sort of a dialect, it would just seem totally out of place.
I suppose so. I've been told that I have a period face, which I'm not quite sure what that means. I think it sort of means that my face and my look is quite fits into a period drama, is quite old-fashioned, I guess. And I think my voice kind of goes with that. But we did do an American accent. So I actually have an American accent in the show. Yes, some of the older characters have English accents, but I think what they wanted to do was sort of unify the accents because, yeah, like you say, loads of different accents might have been confusing to viewers. But I do think that back in the day, it was a melting pot of different influences and different people from lots of different places. So I think it was more of a choice from the creator and the showrunner. That everyone would sort of sound the same, so that you know when you sort of tune in to a certain accent, you're in it. I think they didn't want to overly complicate too many flavors in the
Yeah.
dish, might have got confusing.
And
Yeah.
Tamzin, before we bring you away from Halem for a minute, just a quick note on the special effects throughout the series of Halem, and that there's an awful lot of ooh and ah sort of moments in terms of what they can do. And well, were you sort of, I imagine that some of it was done through green screen. Were you sort of taken back when you saw the visual product? Product or the project when it all was sort of wrapped up episode in terms of, because you can only imagine as an actress what those sort of things look like. Were you pleasantly surprised?
Yeah, you know what? We had an amazing makeup effects team on Salem, a man called Matthew Mungall, who is absolutely brilliant. And he made a lot of the effects practical. So what was fantastic is that as an actor, I was acting opposite the real thing rather than a tennis ball, you know, or a green cross on a screen. I was acting opposite a person dressed as a full hag, you know, or someone dressed as the devil. And that is really cool because then you have to do less work as an actor. You can just be in the moment more and be kind of astonished. And the astonishment that you see on my face, and sometimes the fear, is very real. There's one moment where I grab someone by the tongue and pull them towards me, and it was a big silicon tongue that the actor had to hold in his mouth, and I was holding this tongue, but it really looked and felt really real, and that for me will always be an odd memory to have.
And Tamzin Merchant, I'm going to take you away now from Halem for a few minutes. And 2023 and 2024, exciting times for you, delving into a new universe, a new horizon, a sort of a new landscape, where I imagine it's quite scary starting off. I have done it myself now in the last year or so. I've written a fiction novel as well, so I know what it's sort of, I know what it's sort of like as well in terms of that. Nine months went into my one. But can you tell me about your new novel, your new book, The Hat Makers and the Map Makers, and can you tell me what it's about?
Of course, yeah. Well, funnily enough, I got the idea for The Hat Makers, which is my first book, when I was filming a show in Prague. I had a late night costume fitting, as you do when shows get kind of crazy, and I had a dream after this costume fitting, because in the fitting they were talking about having a special hat made, and the costume designer was saying that they'd have to get a special hat maker to make this hat in London. And that night I had this dream about a family of magical hat makers who lived in London, who made special hats that were kind of woven with magic for and sold them in their hat shop. And I woke up at 4:30 in the morning with this completely vivid dream in my head and this idea that it should be a book. And I woke my partner up and told him about it. And he told me to write it down. So I did. And then, yes, I started the long, as you know, the long process of writing.
Did you get a writer's block? Did you get writer's block at certain
absolutely.
Stages when you start to, there's certain days can be so productive, you can reel off maybe 2-3 chapters, and other days in you get to a page and you just have to leave it for maybe 2 or 3
absolutely.
Days to come back, because you did the brain is sort of fried, the creative juices. I found that particular, that's why it took so long. You could get a surge and you could go and day to day and you'd reel off maybe 3 or 4, and then there could be a week in where you just have to park it really.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a really fascinating process, actually, isn't it? Like the process of trying to create something out of nothing. It's a sort of alchemy in itself, I think. And it's, yeah, for me, I'm now just starting to write my fourth book. And I'm still fascinated by the process of how I work and how I don't work sometimes. And it's a really quite a beguiling and frustrating thing. And I think that it's really, for me, the way that I write is that I do 3 hours a day. I time myself and I have to literally time it, and I'll put my phone with the timer going like on the other side of the room, and I'll just write. And even if I'm just sitting there staring at a blank page, I have to sit there. So it can be quite an arduous thing. But after 7 drafts, I wrote my first book was finished, and it's published by Puffin. And then the sequel is called The Map Makers, which is continuing the story of the main character. And then the third and potentially final in the arc of Cordelia Hatmaker is coming out next week, and it's called The Troublemakers, and it's about pirates. So.
And I know in terms of Ireland, in terms of the online market, I know my book is on amazon.co.uk. Can you find your books there on amazon.co.uk as well for purchase?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, it's on Amazon, and they're in bookshops, and so hopefully people will be able to find both of our books.
Yeah, true. And I suppose for the final 30 seconds, Tamzin Merchant, I'm going to turn it over to you. You might enlighten all our audience why they should tune in to Halem, Salem, if they haven't seen it before. And what's in store for them?
All right. So I think you should tune into Salem for a sort of wild, witchy, exciting thrill ride through 1600s America. And I think right now is the perfect time to get into a box set, isn't it? Dark nights, cold weather, sit down with a nice brew of some kind, a witch's brew if you're feeling brave, and sit down on the sofa and tune in to this kind of quite wild, unpredictable tale of witchy women in America
on
taking
that
revenge.
note.